Hi, everyone. This is the Brad Free Report for February 1st, a big weekend of racing at Santa Anita on Saturday, February 2nd. A couple of graded stakes races, the Grade 3 Bob Lewis for three-year-olds, the Grade 2 San Pasqual for older horses. But the big news on Saturday, of course, is the mandatory force out in the Rainbow Pick 6. The jackpot is more than $1.5 million going into the Friday card. And track officials are expecting a gross pool somewhere in the range of $10 million. So it's a good day to take a swing. It's going to be a wet day to take a swing. We'll talk a little bit about what we might expect with regards to the Rainbow Six. We'll talk about some wet track handicapping, take a look at the two stakes races that will be run on Saturday that are included in the Rainbow Six sequence. Let's start off talking about what we might expect with the Rainbow Six. And I went back and looked at some previous mandatory payouts from around the country to see what might be in store on Saturday. Well, the biggest pool ever was last January at Gulfstream Park. The mandatory payout, the mandatory pool, was $3.9 million last January 28th. New money into the pool, $15 million, and the 20-cent payoff, more than $15,000. And by the way, that $15,000 payoff, that included the shortest price in the entire sequence, an odds-on favorite named First Distinction, who won the race, and yet the 20-cent payoff was still more than $15,000. I know I'm backtrack handicapping, but the point is this. If you liked First Distinction, it was basically a pick five. April of 2017 at Gulfstream Park, and this is the one that I think probably more closely resembles what we're looking at Saturday at Santa Anita. The jackpot was 1.9, new money into the pool, $7 million, and the 20-cent payoff, $48,000. Now, the last time there was a mandatory payout at Santa Anita, November 4th of last year, the jackpot pool was $1.1 million. Bettors poured $6.7 million into the pool. Five winning favorites, one-third choice, and the 20-cent Rainbow Six paid a whopping $601. It was at least a little bit higher than the June 12th mandatory at Golden Gate Fields. $1.4 million jackpot, new money $4.5 million. And the 20-cent Rainbow Six paid $146. That deserves an asterisk because two races in the sequence were moved from grass to the main track after the sequence began. That's why it paid only $146. So on Saturday at Santa Anita, the Rainbow Pick Six, it's going to pay somewhere between $146 and $15,000. I'm going to aim low with regards to my ticket. It looks to me like a sequence that is handicappable, maybe does not have a lot of long shot potential. But maybe the wet track possibly could play into the situation on Saturday at Santa Anita because the rain will resume late Friday, early Saturday. And we'll be looking at a wet track Saturday at Santa Anita. We had a wet track on Thursday at Santa Anita. The track was super fast. And let's talk a little bit about wet track handicapping. Through last weekend, we'd had 24 wet track races. Favorites won 13 of them, a 54% win rate for favorites. Now, Thursday, favorites went 0-for-8, and yet the highest payoff was $8.60. The point I'm making is that just because the track is wet does not mean that you throw form out the window. If anything, wet track handicapping so far this winter at Santa Anita has been very predictable. The average field size for wet tracks through last weekend was only 6.0 starters per race. Thankfully, for the pick six on Saturday, average field size nearly 9 per race in the pick six sequence. The median payoff, half higher, half lower, $5.40. And as far as running style, now the track was definitely speed conducive on Thursday. But so far this winter at Santa Anita, a wet track has been a fair track. 7 gate-to-wire winners, 10 pace pressers, and 7 from the back of the pack. So the idea that speed wins everything on a wet track is really not necessarily the case. It's true that on Thursday, speed was definitely an attribute, but I would go into the Saturday card assuming the racetrack will play fair. Let's talk about the three-year-old race. By the way, the Rainbow Six is on races 5 through 10. It begins with a maiden race. The second leg of the sequence is race number 6, and it's the Grade 3 Robert B. Lewis. A field of 6 entered this race, and there really are only 3 prime contenders, and they're drawn on the outside. Gunmetal Gray at 9-5, the likely pace setter, and morning line favorite, number 5, Mucho Gusto, and number 6, Nolo Contesto. And we'll talk a little bit about the speed they earned by Nolo Contesto in just a minute. I'm going to use all 3 in my pick 6. I cannot distinguish between the 3. I chose number 4, Gunmetal Gray, based largely on his most recent start. It was January 5th in the Grade 3 Sham Stakes, and he was dead last early. Gunmetal Gray was. They were rolling up front, and jockey Mike Smith swung Gunmetal Gray to the far outside, gave him some left-handed reminders, and that's Gunmetal Gray storming down the middle of the track to win this race, going away by 1 length with an 82 buyer speed figure, validating the form of the Breeders' Cup Juvenile. He was 5th in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile. Now, you can see there are 6 horses together at the wire in the Sham on January 5th, and that's often the sign of a low-rated race. It's also true that Gunmetal Gray benefited from a collapsing pace up front, but a couple reasons to believe that he's not entirely pace dependent. He has run well from a pressing position in the past, and he is absolutely bred to love a wet track. He's by exchange rate. His dam, class of 63, won twice on wet, and she also produced a wet track winner. So Gunmetal Gray, likely to be running on a wet track Saturday for the first time. And he is absolutely bred top and bottom to relish the off going. He's my top selection, but as I said, I'm going to use all 3. As for number 5, Mucho Gusto, he'll set the pace. And he finished 2nd last time out behind the highly regarded Improbable and Los Al Futurity. Mucho Gusto, if he catches another speed conducive track, he could be long gone. And by the way, the Los Al Futurity, it's starting to look like it might be a pretty good race. 2 horses from that race have won subsequent races, including 3rd place finisher Extra Hope, who scored a relatively decent win on Thursday, an allowance win. Savagery came back a couple starts later to also win from the Los Al Futurity. Mucho Gusto, the horse to catch. He's the pace setter. As for Nolo Contesto, he's a very interesting horse. His buyer speed figure was only 80 last time out. But for speed figure services that incorporate ground loss into the equation, well, Nolo Contesto is absolutely the horse to beat. He was wide on both turns, and he earned a thoroughgraph number that buries this field, a 2.5 on thoroughgraph for the 2nd start 3-year-old. And this guy's going places. I won't be at all surprised to see Nolo Contesto go favored. He should get a great trip sitting 2nd behind Mucho Gusto. It's a good race, some good 3-year-olds. There are no game winners in the field. There are no improbables in the field. But we're going to find out more about Gunmetal Gray, Mucho Gusto, and Nolo Contesto. I'll be using all 3. My top selection is the closer, Gunmetal Gray. Race number 9 at Santa Anita on Saturday is the Grade 2 San Pasqual. This is a good, solid race. A mile and 1/8 for older horses. A field of 8 entered, and the morning line favorite, number 7, Mackenzie, coming off a smashing win in the Grade 1 Malibu Stakes. That race was 7 furlongs. The San Pasqual is a mile and 1/8. Mackenzie also benefited from a potential outside bias on opening day of the winter meet. Now he's going to be going long for the first again, and a wet track. This horse is not exactly bred for a wet track. I know this Tomlinson number came back at a 402, which suggests a wet track would be okay. I'm not convinced, but I am convinced that Battle of Midway can handle a wet track because he has done it in the past, and his most recent runner-up finish, I'm talking about number 8, Battle of Midway, he finished 2nd in the San Antonio, but he ran better than the winner Gift Box. That's Battle of Midway, down on the inside. He went after a pretty quick pace, 46-3, 111. He fought back through the lane. Gift Box, the winner on the outside, had a perfect trip, sitting 4th behind dueling leaders. Battle of Midway tried to fight back. He was 2nd across the wire. In my opinion, he ran the best race of all. Gift Box has not entered back in the San Pasqual, so Battle of Midway, from his outside post, he should get a great trip, and he also is proven over a wet track. So what about Mackenzie? Well, I know that he won the mile and 1/8 Pennsylvania Derby, a race that earned a big number on all speed figure services, including buyer and thoroughgraph. But there's still some doubt whether that race was as good as the number. And there's still a question in many people's mind, myself included, whether McKenzie is truly a mile and one eighth horse. Also not sure about the wet track. So I respect McKenzie. In fact, I picked him as the most probable winner, but I also will be using Battle of Midway. Those two horses probably lock up the race for Rainbow Six bettors, but Dalmore and Dabster both have speed. Giant Expectations is his own worst enemy. He breaks slowly every single time. When he puts it all together, he is good enough to defeat a field such as this. So I'm going to be using Giant Expectations at 12-1, at least on a backup ticket. But the race revolves mostly around McKenzie and Battle of Midway. Okay, time for the thumbs up, thumbs down segment of the Brad Free Report. And this week, I've got nothing to complain about. So we're going to go with a couple of thumbs up. Two thumbs up. First of all, jockey Kent DeSormo, Hall of Fame jockey Kent DeSormo, scored the 6,000th win of his career last weekend for trainer Jim Cassidy on XS Gold. DeSormo ranks 19th all time. He's 48 years old. He's been in the Hall of Fame for a number of years, and it's been a joy to watch DeSormo ride. I remember back in the 1990s when he was riding Kostroma and Best Pal for Gary Jones. He won three Kentucky Derbies, Real Quiet, Fusayishi Pegasus, Big Brown. Kent DeSormo is a jockey that can think on his feet during – well, think on, in the saddle, I should say, because I don't remember or recall a jockey who can kind of orchestrate trips more effectively than DeSormo. He can change direction and or strategy in a heartbeat, and that's one reason why he's won 6,000 races, and he's not done yet. He has his sights set on Eddie Delahousie, who has 6,383 career wins, DeSormo and Delahousie, both from Cajun country, and DeSormo would like nothing better than to catch Delahousie before he eventually retires. The second thumbs up, well, it has to go to City of Light. He romped in the Pegasus. By the way, we talked about the odds for the Pegasus a couple weeks ago. I was wrong about the favoritism, not wrong about the most probable winner. I thought City of Light had a chance to maybe go favored. Well, he ran like he should have been. He won the Pegasus in an absolute romp. He retires having won six races from 11 starts, $5.6 million. A terrific training job by Michael McCarthy. Javier Castellano was aboard. Boy, you have to wonder, what could City of Light have done in 2019 as a five-year-old? I think he would have probably run the table. But he's off to stud at Lane's End. Two thumbs up. Kent DeSormo, 6,000 wins. City of Light, he goes out a winner in the Pegasus. That's a wrap for the Brad Free Report. I do want to talk briefly about the horse that I will be singling in the Rainbow Six. It's the 3-1 favorite in race number 10. It's a 12-5 claimer N2L. His name is Coyote. 3-1, I'll take it in the final race, race number 10, on Saturday at Santa Anita. For more coverage of the Rainbow Six, make sure DRF.com and also DRF Live on Saturday. We will have extensive all-day coverage. Looking forward to diving into the mandatory payout in the Rainbow Six on Saturday. This is the Brad Free Report, and I'll see you next time.